Welcome to the City of Greater Sudbury. My name is Cassiana Crane and this is my hometown. Now there are a few things that you should know about the City of Greater Sudbury. It's actually made up of several smaller, recently amalgamated towns spread in and around an ancient billion-year-old meteor crater, thought to be one of the largest in the whole world. It's a very expansive city. It's the largest by area in Ontario and it's actually home to more than 160,000 people. The city is located where the deciduous forest of the south meets northern Ontario's boreal forest. And to top it all off, it's also home to more than 330 lakes. But the city of Greater Sudbury wasn't always an example of the natural splendor of Ontario. The city of Greater Sudbury has undergone an almost unbelievable environmental change within the past 100 years. Today, this is a typical view of the city of Greater Sudbury. Notice all that greenery? Well, the typical view in the 1960s was very different. Barren and lifeless. Sudbury was so infamous for this barren, rocky landscape that we even earned the nickname Moonscape. People said that Sudbury looked like the surface of the moon, and honestly, looking at pictures like this, I can see it. This picture was taken right in the center of town in 1981. I, for one, find it kind of shocking that the city that I live in today used to look like this. And that's because this is what the same spot looks like today. This transformation is called regreening. You could also say ecological restoration or reclamation, but today we're going to stick with regreening. And this regreening of Sudbury is not just something that happened all by itself. The regreening of the city of Greater Sudbury is a project. The result of more than 40 years of teamwork and cooperation between government and industry and scientists and citizens. Today, I would like to share this Sudbury regreening story with you. Why it was necessary and how it was and is possible. The first thing that we are going to have a look at is what happened here in Sudbury to create the moonscape. Sudbury, after all, was not always a city of bare rock. To understand what happened, we are going to rewind, go back in time, back to the 1800s. In those days, this part of the country was so dominated by old-growth pine forest that the town that would one day become the city of Greater Sudbury was originally named for those trees. Fun fact, the original name was Saint Anne de Pin, or Saint Anne of the Pines. These giant pines were one of the first casualties of the industrialization of this region. Many were lost in the very early days of our history. However, logging isn't really the industry that created the city of Greater Sudbury that we know today. That honor belongs to mining. You see, the rock here in Sudbury is very rich in metals. That's actually something that you can see when you look at chunks of rock like this one. There are clues here that tell us, and that told the early prospectors, about the sorts of metal we can find in the rock. The rust along the edges? That's from the iron. And that purple shiny bit? Those are traces of copper and nickel. When mining started here in the 1880s, those two became the main metals mined here in Sudbury. Since then, Sudbury hasn't earned nicknames like the Nickel City for nothing. The Big Nickel, a very famous landmark of ours, if you're not familiar, was built to commemorate the fact that Sudbury actually became the nickel capital of the world. And for years, most of the world's nickel was mined right here. There's a very good reason for that, of course. Nickel is very useful. For example, you need nickel to make stainless steel, and you need stainless steel to make pretty much everything. Well, maybe not everything, but we can for sure say that we are constantly surrounded by stainless steel in our modern lives. For example, in the kitchen, stainless steel. The tools we use, stainless steel. Even vehicles like airplanes and cars require stainless steel parts. And electric cars? Nickel is used to make their batteries. And nickel made Sudbury. We have the city we have today because of the discovery of these metals in our rock. But unfortunately, this all came at a very high cost to our environment. Because mining, if not done responsibly, can have some pretty seriously harmful effects on nature. Principally here because of the process of smelting. The purpose of smelting is to extract the metals we want from the rock that we've dug up from underground. That rock is called ore, and it's a mixture of all different kinds of metals, like copper and nickel, as well as minerals like sulfur. To get those metals out of that rock, we have to smelt it. We have to apply heat, melt it down so they can be separated out. The catch is that this process also produces waste. Like, for example, smoke. In that smoke, we can find several ingredients that can pollute and cause harm to our environment. Teeny tiny pieces of the metals themselves can actually escape into that smoke. And when they escape into the smoke, they end up in the environment, they end up in the soils and in the water. And those metals can make it very difficult for plants to grow. And when the sulfur in the rock burns, it turns into sulfur dioxide gas, which can in turn cause all sorts of problems for the environment. Plants can get pretty sick from breathing in sulfur dioxide, and it makes it very difficult for them to survive and grow. Another thing that happens is when sulfur dioxide mixes with water, it creates an acid. And when you get that acid forming in the water in clouds, for example, you get acid rain. And that acid rain, when too much acid rain falls to Earth, soils become very, very acidic. And when soils are too acidic, it's also very difficult for plants to grow. Acid rain also falls into lakes and rivers and creeks, and when too much of it does, it can make it very hard or even impossible for anything, including fish, to survive. Historically then, here in Sudbury, this pollution from smelting caused a lot of problems, and that was because all that smoke with the sulfur dioxide and the metals went right into the environment. And to cause the kind of devastation we saw here in Sudbury throughout our history, we produced a lot of that pollution. It started off with the roast yards. The roast yards were the technology that we were using for smelting in the earliest days of the mining industry here in Sudbury. They were pretty straightforward. All they were huge beds of wood. So this wood was from trees that were cut down, and on top of the wood, they piled up the ore. Once they'd done that, they lit the roast yard on fire. These roast yards were enormous. Can you see that smudge right there in the center of the red circle? That's actually a person standing on the roast yard. So look at the size of him compared to the size of that roast yard. Imagine all the wood it took to build these and all the smoke that was produced every time they burned, because when they burned, they would burn for months at a time. And that smoke was very rich, very full of sulfur dioxide. It got right into the forest. It caused a lot of devastation. The last roast yard here in Sudbury was decommissioned in 1929, which means that we were using roast yards here in Sudbury for 40 years. And imagine living here in Sudbury during that time. It must have been a very difficult environment to live in. After we were done with the roast yards, we switched over to just using smelters, which are more similar to what we have today. However, the smelters we had in those early days weren't really any better for the environment. The main difference between the roast yards and those old smelters were that the smelters used smokestacks to disperse the smoke, which meant that the smoke was able to spread out better. This is a good thing, and it's a bad thing. Spreading the smoke out makes it less severe, more diluted, but it also means that it travels further and therefore impacts a larger area. Today, what is very cool is that at modern smelters, they can use new technologies to remove a lot of the pollutants, like sulfur dioxide, from the smoke. That's made a huge difference to our environment, and we'll take a bit of a closer look at how much of a difference in the next video. Here it is again, that picture of Sudbury in the 1960s. So let's review. What happened to make the moonscape? The first step was deforestation. The largest trees were cut down the earliest for logging, and after that, many of the smaller trees were cut down to build the roast yards. The next step, which was more serious, was the pollution itself. So sulfur dioxide, metals that were coming out of smelting. This smoke made it very difficult for plants to survive. And as more acid rain and other emissions fell, the poorer the soil became and the harder it became for new plants to grow. Another issue that came packaged in along with all of this was erosion. Erosion is the term for the displacement or the loss of soil. You see, plants with their roots hold the soil in place. It's kind of like a net. When you lose plants and you lose their roots, the wind and the rain can actually wash the soil away into lakes and into rivers where it definitely does not belong. In Sudbury, erosion was such a problem because we lost so many plants. So much soil was able to erode away that we were left in a lot of places with just bare rock. That's why when you look here, you can see so many rocks. The soil that used to cover those rocks has washed away. If you were standing in the same spot 150 years ago, you would not have been able to see all this rock. It would have been underneath the soil. I can tell looking at this picture because I can see the roots of all these old tree stumps. Now, you really should not be able to see the roots of trees, right? They should be under the soil, but here we can see them because the soil that used to cover them washed away. To give you a clearer idea, this is another tree stump where we can see those roots, and I actually had to climb up on top of those roots to take this picture. So we can imagine that the soil that used to cover these roots was probably over a meter deep. All this erosion made it even more difficult to plant trees because trees need soil to grow in.
Today in the city of Greater Sudbury, it's difficult to find barren areas like these, and that's because people have taken action. This all really got started in the 1960s and 70s when attitudes towards environmental protection were changing around the world. Here in Sudbury, people started taking steps to repair their devastated environment. They started the long road to regreening. Tune in to the next video in the series to find out how.